The Center for Innovation and Technology is offering you a golden opportunity to speak directly to your market at an affordable price. We also offer media training workshops, live streaming, documentary production, and events management. Get in touch with us today on the following numbers. +263-867-711-0290 or 0718-100-235. Don't forget to subscribe to our social media platforms. Like our Facebook page, Center for Innovation and Technology. Follow us on Twitter at SideZW. You can also check out our website, www.side.org.z.
My first frustration is whether we need elections at all, or we just need to beat people in the same way that I know my brother, the traditional leader there, is already saying, yes, we don't need elections. The other frustration is the effort that we've invested in elections in the past 40 years versus the dividends. I think generally the dividend is the legalization or because you have the benefit of previous election. So I quickly go to this talk. So after 2018, do we need to do the first past the post approach or not? One of the noisiest things is that we've got two default successors. When I say default, I know people from ZANU-PF and people from Alliance would throw stones at me. The way in which the two main candidates came to power was not the cleanest of ways. And therefore, the need for the election resided in the idea of cleansing themselves. So if the election was going to be good for one, it was going to be the best. That's the logic of the change that we've been using, watershed election. They might not be watershed at all. Then, there were high stakes, because I'm close to 50 now, and they think dependents are not in voting age. They thought, well, by the moment I get into retirement, we are likely to see things differently, and there's the circumstances where they've changed. And of course, our leadership and the approach to leading, they've changed. Did that happen? Did that not? So these are things that are fueling the 2018 election. Then there's another argument that, well, if they over 60 or so percent, I think the employee argument may indicate better. If over 60% or so are youths, and the youths are the dominant population, they are likely to make a logical decision because they are very literate, they are informed, they are whatever. And you can go on. The commas are too many. Then is another thing. The space has been liberated, they've been riding on tankers, we've restored legacy. And we can't detach ourselves from that euphoria because the excitement was too much. We want to a crescendo, right? We want to go high on it. And so the election was supposed to be on some of these things. With some degree of frustration, of course, we did not deliver on most of the expectations. So you can understand why we are worried and why the conference was convened. Very important is the idea that James mentioned. It's very critical because one of the things that we think is that we just want cleaners, we want environment to be good, we want the economy to function. But the parties themselves were not healthy. Political parties were not healthy at all, whichever party you belong to. So that's a problem. We can't expect good election from unhealthy players. And that even if the state was going to be very plain and smart, the internal structures and complexities, contradictions, fights, conflicts inside the parties would have spoiled the party. And it's a claim I'm making, I'm not saying it's a political. And there's a new thing happening. Key politicians, key players are challenged by younger players. And they want to displace them because they think that, well, your generation is over. And we are supposed to create a generation of our own because the leadership flare that is different. If, for instance, a year ago, we had removed Mugabe on the basis of malgovernance, and the tool for removal was the military. The military changed. This is a simple question. It's not for this example. The military changed enough to tolerate an election instead of the very strong legal support. So if they don't change, why did they go to vote? Because they are still, their stakes were still there in the open. So James' idea of the involvement of these key actors might shape the direction of our election. I don't want to talk about this fundamental because they may not be very important, but I just want to reiterate this one. If we want to build the nation, do we need the first past the post? Because it's very exclusionary. But if we want winners and losers, yes, the first past the post is a very good indicator because it's very pragmatic and objective. We just count the numbers. But for the logic of establishing a nation which many people are talking about today, and I think my friend Kamis is there. We've talked a lot about this idea of building a nation is a complex methodology, it's a complex thing than the one that we think is just placing pieces of paper in a box. So we have placed too many papers, but we are still struggling to identify ourselves. Okay. Is there a problem with this one? Several problems. The constitution problem is 50-50. And I think we were here with the gender commission at some point. The constitution says equality. But the parties say no. All political parties literally say no. They are putting their main actors onto the platform. And we still want justice. So there are contradictions that we have acted out of the election. We have exhibited serious contradictions through our election. And there are several other things around the electoral act, around the regulations. Code of conduct, for example. Is the code of conduct a binding tool? Do we really obey the bashing that happened through social media and directly to some individual who are contesting? And of course, to the Zed chair. Can we not sanction some actors? And those who follow the law, we set good precedent if we do that. Assume that we are honest when we do it. But if we set the precedent that people who act in this manner during the electoral process can be punished, that can be a very good indicator. Not for you, because we are too old to change, but for our kids. Another very important thing is we have made election a very much legal thing. I am trying to imagine the Dexter and Luna story. So the election resulted in invented or whatever the case was. I'm using BSA language here because I'm not a lawyer. So, and the exec admits that the numbers have been twisted. So, do we need to go to law or we need just to be honest and clean as a nation? So these are small things. They're not big things at all, but they are small things. But the next thing in terms of, okay, what if it happens to the presidential candidates? If you want to think better, also think about yourself and the others. If you think just about yourself, you don't listen well. What if the result has been invented for the president and his next candidate? Would that have helped? That's what you are saying. Would Zed sustain that claim? And so there's a lot of weaknesses with the web of the technical legal web. And I'm not saying we should undo the law, we can't do without it. Let's go here a little bit. What did we do? And I think there's a scholar who sort of says, argues that, well, the best way to understand what to do next is to know what you didn't like before. If we've done some things very well, and we've got the capacity to do well, It means our systems, a political party level, a disaster level, a disaster level, a electoral level, could actually improve. And that's not the idea, but it's any new thing. We are capable of making our electoral system very functional and good and deliver. Is ZEC independent? It's listed along the independent commission. Is it independent? And that question is not mine. It's for us to say, well, after registering voters, where do you put the disabled? It's a simple question. And you can say, no, they are at the House, it's at Sheraton, it's at our office. What's wrong with that? Who among us would table with that say? So we don't understand why people say no, we can't disclose that because it's a civility. Which civility is that now? Because the most important thing that we need to secure is the ballot. The rest of the country is infrastructure. So there are things that we are worried about which are not necessarily worried. And there are things that we should be worried about which you are not worried about. I will speak some things. So imagine, we are going to talk about the BVR issues. So those numbers, those constituencies, where are they? Who keeps the law? Where is the safe? This type of question. Nomination points. So from where we are coming, the excitement of 2018 was that, well, the nomination court could just not do enough in one day. We had to stretch. So even if there was something good about the election, it was the excitement was there and the constituencies that we were supposed to be interested in were really up to it. Why is it critical that people who participate in voter education go through state for rubber stamp, authorizing, whatever? And I don't say that's wrong. I'm just saying, why should that be the liberty for someone to participate in voter education? I'm also sure what the reason, because all of us, one way or the other, do voter education in our homes. So even if you don't go through it. So there's a lot of things that we structure and think we form this way. But in practice, there are other tools and approaches that are happening which you are not necessarily focusing on. I will know the cycle, but the cycle is just as important as anything else that I'm saying. Ah. ERC says, can you help the law? And there seems not to be clarity of which law. Because we could actually use the law as an audit too. So if you don't have the law, how do we perform? And how do we see whether the people who registered are the same people who are voting? And these are things that should just be given to people, allow people to vote in a context where everything else is clear. And I think I'm still talking about transparency. Can we make this thing cleaner? So this would allow us, if we had gotten the law, the provisional law, it would allow us to measure and assess the difference between that law and what became our final law. All parties need that. And if all parties need that, so why keep it away from you? This would answer a lot about the mass waste story. 300,000 voted after 1 o'clock, after 3 o'clock. You would not mind the time, as long as they got the rules. If they vote in 1 minute, it's good enough because they are in the road. But the moment people start to say, where did they come from at 3 o'clock? And you know what 3 o'clock means in the village, fetching water, making sure the village is there, and whatever. And so people are saying, why would this happen in the village? And there's nothing very sinister about it. I'm just trying to say, let's invite our people into making sure that those suspicions are erased. The moment we erase them, we are going to go. Announcement of results. Everyone wants to announce. And everyone announces. And let me just say this from a non-legal perspective. If you post them, you've literally made a claim that this is the outlook of things. Why are we worried about looking at who says what? I don't even understand that. Because the logic of it is that the numbers are there. So if I say these are the ones that I use, and I say, well, these are the ones that I collected, am I wrong? Okay, technically, yes, because you're not supposed to say those numbers. But actually, those are realities. If they are real, Then I think we are focusing our energies to the right direction. I think what is it that we mean when you say announce the results? Because if someone records it, you know, we are busy taking snapshots right now of the screen, and you go and say, this is what was said. Is it completely wrong? Okay, so let's go here. If results are only announced by say, and this is the lunar story, this is the lunar story. The change can only happen on the basis of say, recommending recount. Now, if he doesn't recommend recount, he lose. Even if they know that the results are actually invalid. And I'm saying, we are in a mess with the law. We are abusing the law. These documents, our constitution, our electoral act, and everything else, they are very smart. We are not very smart. I think we are using very updated documents when we are very outdated ourselves. If voting made any difference, people would not allow themselves to vote. So if you know that people are going to oust me from this house, from being the father of the house, would you call for an election? Definitely not. I'm just saying this so that we reflect. I would say it's always okay. The people who cast the votes decide nothing. The people who count the votes decide everything. Is it always correct or is it not? Can we twist that argument and say that the people who cast made the decision, the people who come are simply doing a technical process? Electoral dispute resolution, couple of things, 2 minutes. Some of the, what we call that paper that you get, the ballot paper, right? Some of the individuals have got their faces turning female on that day when they are male, or turning male when they are female. And then they go for a contest to say, well, I am not well represented on the ballot paper. The process is such that who should be blamed? The problem with most of us is that we always want to say, okay, this was to blame, this part was to blame, and that's the wrong thing they did in our process. Because you want to find who is guilty, we had to look for who is right, or what is right, not who, what is right. So we have had issues like that. We have had issues where people actually confess that, well, ballots were stashed in these ballot papers there, and the process of opening is one that people don't want to do. But they know that inside there is something that is not necessarily a reflection of the voters, the voters' interest. So we have not seen that issue that we have. Imagine, let's go to this idea of electoral dispute resolution, and this is based on my last comment. Is it possible that on that bench there are also activists? All right, the other way, is it not possible that the bench can also have activists? Okay, is it possible that lawyers can also be activists? Because to be a judge, to be a lawyer, and then eventually nominate a judge. So is it possible that the judgments can also be wrong? Judges prepared for electoral dispute. In an administrative sense, we need to go to the papers and ask ourselves. They know the law, but they don't know the administration. That's why we found a case where opposite parties were saying we're told to observe the printing of the papers from where the banner is. Technically, there's no reason to go there. Why would you go and stay and watch something in 30 meters when you would have remained where you are? So there are technical things that we can add out. Why not just give the meter away? Remember, there's a lot of thick glasses. This one. Put the thick glass there and let them watch within 30 centimeters. These things are administratively doable. Why are we failing to do them? And I don't think the paper will soon use the glass. So there are these things that we have done wrongly, and reiterate. First of all, the Rose came story. Did the people gather? Yes. Did someone testify that he voted during that process? No. Therefore, it didn't happen. Zimbabwe.